We're going to be in Genesis chapter 22 this morning. This is probably one of my top favorite passages in the Old Testament. It is an incredible passage. When I remember as a young man hearing a sermon by a famous preacher on it, and it was called, what did he call it? He called it, I forget the name of the title, but the point I was going to make is that the text was all about man and man's vantage point and man being tested. And it was called The Death of a Promise. That's what it was called, The Death of a Promise. And I want to tell you, this passage is such a glorious passage because it's about Christ. It's about Christ. From beginning to end, it's about Christ. Christ is our provision. I've titled this, He Gave His Only Son. This is the passage where Abraham is tested to give his son, the only son that he loves. This phraseology of your only son is used. And of course, Isaac is not Abraham's only son. He has another son, Ishmael. But when God says, your only son, what he means is your unique son, your son of promise, your heir, the one in whom all the promises that I've ever made to you about becoming a great nation, about all the nations being blessed, will be fulfilled through Isaac. And I am asking you to go on a 3-day journey and to offer up your only son, the only son that you love, your only beloved son, and offer him up on a mountain. Well, of course, if Abraham does this, this has to create great conflict. If I offer up my only son, how will all the promises of God come to pass? And as we shall see, Abraham answers that with resurrection, that God is able to bring up his son even from death in order to bring his promise to pass, because God is a covenant-keeping God. God keeps his vows and oaths. And God makes a promise to all of us, to Abraham, to his seed, to all that believe, that he will provide for us an atonement for our sins. That he will provide it. It's not something we can provide for ourselves. The answer of most religions to the sin problem is do better, work harder, do something sacrificial. And God says, no, I will do something sacrificial. I will give my beloved son in place of your sins. And so this is a very powerful passage. Let's stand this morning for the reading of God's word in Genesis chapter 22. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham. And he said, here I am. He said, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you. And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac his son. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went both of them together. And Isaac said to his father, Abraham, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. He said, behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Abraham said, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son. So they went both of them together. And they came to the place of which God had told him. Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And he said, here I am. He said, do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from from me. And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in the thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of the place Yahweh Yireh. Yahweh will provide, as it is said to this day, on the mount of Yahweh it shall be provided. And the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, by myself I have sworn, declares the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you, and I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore, and your offspring shall possess the gates of his enemies. And in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because you have obeyed my voice. So Abraham returned to his young men, and they arose and went together to Beersheba, and Abraham lived at Beersheba. Oh, Lord God, we thank you, Father, that you have provided a substitute for us, that you loved us so much that you gave your only son, the unique son, to be a substitutionary atonement for our sins, that all that trust in you will not be disappointed, but have the gift of eternal life. We thank you for this, Lord. It is your work and not ours. And for this, we praise you and bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, you notice this text ends with Abraham lived at Beersheba. That's the conclusion of our text this morning. Abraham lived at Beersheba. And we talked about Beersheba last week and the end of Genesis chapter 21. It was at Beersheba that Abimelech and Abraham make a covenant. And if you recall, Abraham sets aside seven lambs. And Abimelech says, what means these seven lambs? And he says, this is a sign between you and I that I have dug this well. This is my well. And by taking those lambs, Abimelech acknowledges, yes, it is your well. It is your well. And then he departs. They make their covenant. He departs. And Abraham stays at this place, and he names it Beersheba. And Beersheba means two things at once. One, it means the well of seven, because Sheva in Hebrew means seven. But Sheva is also the word for oath. So if you look at it, it says they named it Beersheba because there they made an oath. So the text draws attention to both two things, to that there are seven lambs, number seven, and it draws attention to the fact that a vow is made there. And Abraham plants a tree or a grove of trees, and he calls upon the name of the everlasting God. He lives there in the place. It's called the well. Beer is well. Well of the oath. And seven being a perfect number has a lot of meaning there. It's a perfect oath and it's a perfect vow. And it's the well of the oath. He lives at the well of the oath and he plants it. And I talked last week about how this is a place that the Israelites could go back to 400 years later and find that tree or that grove of trees and say, here our father Abraham made an oath to the Philistine king that he would treat him in a way that was equitable, that he would not unduly harm him. Now, of course, the Philistines break that oath immediately, right away. But it's a reminder, when you make oaths, you keep oaths. When you make vows, you keep vows. And that's where Abraham lives. And he lives there, it says, for many days in the land of the Philistines. Now, our text today begins after that, long time after that. I would say about 28 years. He lives there for a long time. But when he's done with this offering up his son, he goes back and he lives at this place. Now, it's interesting that God here makes an oath to Abraham. He makes a vow to Abraham. And this vow pertains to, in the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. The name of the place, Jehovah Jireh, means in the mount of the Lord it shall be seen. And he swears, the Lord swears. And he reiterates the covenant to him. And Abraham lives in a place at the well of the oath. And that's a picture to me. That he lived in a place that reminded him of his vows and God's vows. He continued there. He lived in the place. And we as believers, we come to faith in Christ. We put our trust in Christ. We believe in the promise of God that he who gave his son for us to die for us accepts us on the basis of what Christ did for us. We have to live out that faith. We continue to live in that faith. Abraham continued to live in the place of the oath. We continue to trust in Christ. We as Christians need to hear the gospel. Sometimes people are like, well, you know, we'd really like to hear something practical. We like to hear, give me some do's and some don'ts. And we need to hear do's and don'ts as Christians. We need to be instructed from God's word. But sometimes Christians think, oh man, that's the gospel again. He's preaching the gospel again. Yes, every Sunday we want to proclaim the gospel. Every Sunday we want to preach Jesus Christ is our satisfaction for sins. Every Sunday we want to remember his body and his blood, that is what we trust in. That is what recommends us to God, is not what we have done, but what Christ has done. And so in this text, we're going to look at that verse by verse. This passage is a very gospel-focused passage. It's about Christ, the substitutionary atonement for our sins. All right, let's look here at verse 1. It says, after these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham, he said, here I am. He said, take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains which I shall tell you. First of all, it says God tested Abraham. I remember in school, and why do they offer tests? Well, the stated reason is, well, we want to see what you know when they test you. We want to see if you're actually learning the subject matter and the material. But from my vantage point, I always found that test day, I learned the most preparing for the test. Because all the lectures and all of that were good. I'm getting concepts, I'm conceptualizing things. But the days before the test, for me, honestly, the night before the test, to about 2 a.m., I'm sitting there and I'm studying. I'm coming up with mnemonic devices. I'm trying to learn. And I learned a lot during that test preparation. But I also learned, wow, some things about me. I didn't realize I could learn so much in a short amount of time. The test period, preparing for the test, taught me that, it's like for a long time I said, oh, I can't memorize scripture. Except for the ones that just all of a sudden somehow I know that I can't memorize scripture. Well, in Bible college, we had a test day where we had to have memorized and write out 50 scriptures and write them out one by one, the address and what it was. I found, wow, I can. It would give you either the number or it would give you the text, and you had to write the other one. And I found out, wow, I can memorize scripture. I learned a lot about myself. Well, testing teaches the teacher something about us. What do we know? And it teaches us something about ourselves, and we learn a lot in the test. God knows everything. God knows Abraham. He knows what we pray before we pray it, but he tests Abraham. I think part of the reason he tests Abraham was not just to know what's in Abraham, because God knows all things, but also so that Abraham would know about Abraham and to know where he was. In Romans 5, I don't have this text for you, but it says that tribulation or testing works patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. We go through tests in our spiritual walk, and sometimes they're very difficult tests in our spiritual walk. And when we come through those tests, we learn about ourselves. Sometimes we learn that we're not as righteous or holy as we thought we were. And sometimes we learn that, wow, God's done something in me. I never would have known that I could have come through that had God not tested me in that way. And sometimes we simply learn, as it says in Romans 5, that it works experience into us and hope into us, because we're like, wow, God brought me through that. God can bring me through the next trial. Well, this test of Abraham, it tests Abraham, and God says, now I know what is in you, Abraham. But God tests all of his people. He tests us. He takes us through trials and testings and tribulations. And sometimes it can really push us. But God will teach us about ourselves, and he'll teach us about his faithfulness. And most importantly, we need to learn about his faithfulness, and we learn to trust in him. So God tests Abraham, and he says specifically, verse 2, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love. Now, I don't know how a Jew reads this, but you read this and you go, this isn't technically true. Because Isaac isn't his only son. He has another son, a son that was a byproduct of his own understanding. God had said, I'm going to make you a father, of many nations. And so he and Sarah said, here, take my handmaid Hagar, lie with her, and then I'll adopt that son of the surrogate mother, and that will be your son. But that's not what God told him to do. That was his own understanding. But that's not the son that's referred to here. When he says your only son, he's saying, you know the son I'm talking about. I'm not asking you for Ishmael. I'm not asking you for the works of your flesh. I'm not asking you to provide something that you came up with. I want you to offer up the son that came by supernatural birth, the son of whom I've said is the heir of everything you have, the son of whom are going to come kings, and I'm going to make into a multitude of nations, the son that you waited 100 years to get. That son, I want you to offer up that son. But the use of the phrase, your only son, comes up in the New Testament also, doesn't it? Now, Jesus is the monogenes. He is, King James says, the only begotten, but ESV, I think, translates it as the unique son. And it's taken, I think the concept is taken from here. I don't know how much theological scrutiny that will break up, hold up to, but it's the same idea. The only begotten son. God has a lot of sons. He has all the angels, the sons of God in Genesis 6. All the angelic beings are called the sons of God. We are the adopted son of God. Abraham is the son that was made. But when we speak of Jesus, the unique son of God, the son that was from all eternity, the Trinitarian son, the son that's without beginning, the eternal son. That's the son that God the Father would give to die for our sins. Not Adam, not an angel, not a creating being, but the unique son, the only son, the monogenes, the Greek word, that son. And also he says, the son whom you love. Think about the times at Jesus' baptism. Jesus speaks from heaven and says, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Also, again, in the Mount of Transfiguration, he speaks from heaven. This is my beloved son. Hear him. He is the beloved son, the beloved. We are chosen in him, in the beloved, from the foundation of the world, Ephesians 1 says. The beloved son is a unique title of God the Son. And here he says to Abraham, take your only son, your unique son, the son of promise, whom you love, your beloved son, and go to the land of Moriah. Why? Now, as I've been doing over and over again, as we've been reading through Genesis, I try to look at this from the perspective of somebody coming out of Egypt in the Exodus. And I don't know what they would think of Moriah. It's like, what's special about Moriah? I don't know of anything that the Exodus generation would know, but they know that what they know, what the first generation knows is God had some reason for Abraham to leave Beersheba and go to a particular place, a specific place, a specific hill in the land of Moriah. Now, where was the land of Moriah? Well, this is the land where earlier in chapter 14, where Abraham meets with Melchizedek at a town then called Jebus, a Canaanite city, which would later be called Jerusalem. He says, I want you to go to a specific place. And it's in the land of Moriah. It's in an area called Moriah, where there's already Melchizedek living. Abraham had interactions with him earlier in Genesis chapter 14. But as we shall see, even though it's in the proximity of Moriah, it's a remote place. It's not in the center of town. It's somewhere outside of town. He said, I want you to take your son to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. A particular mountain. I'll show you when you get there. You go to Moriah, to the land of Moriah, and I want you to offer up your son on a particular mountain, a particular hill there. Now, the Jews will tell you that it's the Temple Mount. And that may be. It's not 100% definite. I don't want to speak with too much authority, but I would say that it seems to me, and other scholars that I've read, that the Temple Mount is close to the center of town. And as we shall see in this text, it's very clear that it's in a remote place. It's not in the middle of town. It's not, you know, Melchizedek isn't in his little palace over there looking at Abraham do these things. He's outside of town. He's in Moriah. He's in the proximity of Jerusalem, but outside of Jerusalem. I want you to go and offer up your only son on a particular hill outside of Jerusalem. That's powerful foreshadowing. Because God would offer his only unique son on a particular hill outside of Jerusalem. That's powerful foreshadowing. And the place is specific. Because as we see, Abraham is going to be spared from offering up his son in actuality. For 3 days, he's as good as dead, but in his mind. But on the third day, God gives him his son back. But when God takes his son to a particular hill outside of Jerusalem in the land of Moriah, his son's going to suffer and die. And God will not spare his son. Verse 3, so Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him and his son Isaac, and he cut the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to the young men, stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you. First thing that's very interesting to me in this text is how many times it talks about the wood. The wood. It's like, it's a detail that comes again and again. The wood. Take the wood. Put the wood on your son. The wood is emphasized. It's highlighted. And as I've read scripture, I've learned, pay attention to all the little details that a nonchalant reader who doesn't expect divine inspiration will just pass right on over. But we as Christians, we look at it and say, wood. The wood, it emphasizes the wood. Why? Because Jesus would be crucified on a tree. Adam disobeyed at a tree. Christ obeyed on a tree. The wood is emphasized again and again in scripture. The tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the tree of life. Jesus' cross is to us who believe a tree of life. To them that is perish, it's the tree of death. But he grabbed up the wood and he took the wood with him from the place where he was. I wonder, doesn't say it in the text, but I wonder if it's wood collected from the tree that he planted, I'll say 28 years earlier. I don't know. Doesn't say so. I don't know. But in any case, where he was living in Beersheba, he collects some of the wood and he goes, he saddles up his donkey, he and two servants. And on the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes. Third day is emphasis. Why tell us how long he traveled? Why emphasize that? Third day comes up again and again in Scripture. Third day, when they would take the Passover lamb and they would put the blood over their doorpost. Remember, God says that you shall take the blood of the lamb and put it over your doorpost, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Meaning when I'm handing out judgment, if I see blood, I won't judge you. A picture of Christ, atoning blood on our behalf. And they were to eat the Passover lamb, but if any of it remained after the third day, it was an abomination. If it was starting to rot, starting to stink, it was an abomination. They could eat it for 3 days, but after that, they were not to eat it. Jesus died for our sins on a cross. The cross, the wood was collected the first day. And for 3 days, Abraham travels, and in his mind, I've got to kill my son. I'm going to Moriah to kill my son. This is my son. I'm going to plunge a knife into his chest and kill my son. God has asked me to kill my son, and I'm going to do it. In his mind, it's an accomplished fact. For 3 days, his son is as dead to him. He knows his son. The sentence is death. That's all he knows. And so he goes for 3 days. 3 days, because Jesus would be in the tomb for 3 days. And on the third day, God would give him back to him again. Now pay attention to this last verse in verse 5. What does he tell the tomb young man? He says, stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and will worship and come again to you. Now he knows he's going to offer up his son, and yet what does he say? He says, we will come again to you. Not I will come again to you. We will come again to you. Now it could be, if you're just reading this, could be, well, maybe Abraham's lying because he's been known to do that. Maybe he doesn't want them to restrain him and say, Abraham, You can't kill your son. That's against the law. And maybe, you know, we could reason that. Maybe you're right. But you're not right, because Hebrews 11 tells us something that we wouldn't know for certain otherwise. Hebrews 11, verse 17. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac. And he who had received the promises was in the act of offering up his only son, emphasis, of whom it was said, through Isaac shall your offspring be named. He considered that God was able even to raise him from the dead, from which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. So the writer of Hebrews tells us that Abraham believed that if he killed his son, and offered him up, that the Lord would raise him up even out of the ashes. By the way, the word burnt offering, the word in Hebrew, olah, means to ascend. It's not burnt offering, it's the word, an offering of ascending. And the reason it's called the offering of ascending is because you didn't eat a burnt offering. A peace offering, the offerer, the priest, they all partook of the peace offering. It's a picture of fellowship with God. There's a portion for the Lord that's offered up in smoke. There's a portion for the priest. There's a portion for the offerer. It's like a barbecue. They share it. That's a peace offering. The burnt offering was different. The burnt offering, they would remove the skin from the burnt offering and they would burn it up in smoke and it would ascend to heaven. And so it was an offering of ascent, and they would burn it up and it would ascend to heaven. So when he's going to offer him up as a burnt offering, it's not, you know, a little lighter to it. No, he's going to be burnt, to burnt, totally ascended. Abraham believes that God is able to raise his son out of the ashes. He believes in the resurrection. He believes that in order for God to fulfill his promise, if God has to raise him up out of the ashes, the everlasting God, the Almighty, will bring him back from the dead in order to fulfill his promise. Abraham has faith in the resurrection. He believes. This faith we're also called to have. When we lay our loved ones in a tomb and their body rots away and we say goodbye, if they know the Lord, if they're trusting in the Lord Jesus, we believe that our spirits will be reunited with them. But more than that, there will be a day when God sends his son back again, when there will be a resurrection of the dead, and we will get our bodies reunited to our spirits. You say, well, what about the bodies that go up in smoke? Well, we believe that God is able to take those particles, those atoms, or the essence of who we are, and raise them up. By the way, your body is... I was just listening to somebody the other day talk about tattoos. When you get a tattoo, body, the whole skin, your whole skin is replaced quite frequently. New skin cells replace old skin cells. But when these, I think it's called phytogens, eat up the ink in the tattoo, they basically die and it stays right where it's at. So it never gets fully purged from the body. The tattoo stays in the skin. But actually, it's really interesting, because the ink, which is between the layers of the skin, stays there. But your skin is renewed. You get, ever so often, you have basically a new body, because your body replaces its cells with new cells. Old cells die and are disposed of, and new cells come. So our body, this body, God is able to know the essence of what our body is and to resurrect it. And whatever that resurrected body is, it's connected to the body that we have. There's going to be a resurrection. We're exchanging out new cells and new, you know, we eat food and it becomes part of us, and we're losing skin cells all the time and skin cells are renewing. But the essence of who we are, God is going to raise our body from the dead. It's going to bring it back. There's going to be a resurrection, and that's what God's going to do on the last day. Abraham believed in the resurrection, and so must we as Orthodox believing Christians. Verse 6, and Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife, so they went both of them together. Isaac carries the wood for his crucifixion. Oh, excuse me, burnt offering. Do you see the connection? Abraham is carrying the wood for his own sacrifice. John 19, 16, it says, so he delivered him over to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and he went out bearing his own cross to the place called the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, and Jesus was between them. Jesus was bearing his own cross, perhaps at the exact same hill that Isaac bore the wood on which he would be offered. Incredible foreshadowing. It's the place of the skull. I've made this connection many times, even in Genesis, that it was at the place of the skull, the seed of the woman crushes the serpent's head. It's an incredible picture. He gets a nail through his heel, and there he defeats Satan by paying for our sins at a particular place. And Isaac said to his father, "My father." And he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So they went, both of them, together. Isaac is connecting dots here. We're going up the hill. I'm carrying the wood. I see the fire. I see the knife. But where's the lamb? And God says, the Lord will provide for himself a lamb. Now that's, he didn't say provide for us a lamb. He says provide for himself. God provided for himself a substitutionary sacrifice that would satisfy himself. We can provide nothing but the sin that makes it necessary. God provides the lamb for the burnt offering throughout. What we've already seen in Genesis. You remember in Genesis 4, the day comes when they offer up a burnt offering. Again, it's a burnt offering. And Abel, being the keeper of the sheep, brings of the flock and of the herd. And Cain, being a tiller of the ground, brings forth the work of his hands. And Abel's blood offering, burnt offering, is accepted, and Abel is accepted. But Cain, God says to Cain, "Why is your face fallen, Cain? If you do good, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do good, then sin lies at the door." In other words, Cain, you know better. I told you what you need to bring is a blood sacrifice. Instead, you've brought the work of your hands. It doesn't say that it was not quality vegetables. I have no doubt if Cain brought what he thought would have been an insulting offering, if he brought the worst of his field, then I don't think he would be, I don't think he'd be angry that he wasn't accepted. But Cain probably brought the best vegetables that he had. But vegetables don't atone for sin. Without the shedding of blood, there is no atonement for sin. Abel brings a lamb. Cain brings his works. To this day, many are trusting in the works of their hands to make them right with God. But it's only the lamb without blemish. It's only the perfect lamb of God that God accepts as an exchange to accept us. Today, the modern gospel emphasizes us accepting Christ. But the gospel of the scripture is about God accepting us through Christ. It's about his acceptance of us. God said, Abraham said, God will provide for himself the lamb. And he did so on Passover. He provided the lamb for himself. Jesus is the Lamb of God. Verse 9, when they came to the place which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. He is affixed to the wood. Like Jesus would be nailed to the cross. It tells us he was bound to the wood. On top of the wood. Again, emphasizing wood. Wood is emphasized again and again in this text. Twice in these verses that I have for you and earlier in the text, he carries the wood. Abraham cuts the wood. The wood is very emphasized. And I believe that's because Jesus wouldn't be offered up with knife and fire, but nailed to a tree. And he was to be offered up as a burnt offering. Leviticus 1 tells us about burnt offerings. Verse 6, Leviticus chapter 1, verse 6 says, Then he, the priest, shall flay the burnt offering. That means you'll take the skin off and cut it into pieces. And the sons of Aaron, the priest, shall put fire on the altar and arrange the wood on the fire. And Aaron's sons, the priest, shall arrange the pieces, the head, the fat, on the wood that is on the fire on the altar. Again, emphasizing the wood, but they were to skin the burnt offering. If they didn't skin the burnt offering, it would be a stench. Because when hair burns, it stinks. But the phrase that's emphasized in Leviticus over and over again, I think 17 times if I remember correctly, is it's a pleasing aroma in the nostrils of the Lord. A sweet-smelling savor unto the Lord is the King James. A sweet-smelling savor. Like I think it's 17 times, if I remember correctly. The sacrifice is not a stench. It's a sweet-smelling aroma. Because the sacrifice of Christ on our behalf pleases the Lord. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. Also, why remove the skin? It was then given to the priests. It became something the benefit to the priests that they got out of the burnt offering, because the rest of it, there's no food in the burnt offering. It all goes up in smoke. But the skin of the burnt offering could be made into leather for clothing, for covering, etc. The first sacrifice for Adam and Eve, the day that they sin, what does God do? He slays an animal and he makes garments for them to cover their nakedness, to cover their shame. We who trust in Christ wear the robe of his righteousness. We're given the covering of his righteousness. We are given his righteousness on our behalf. So they would flay the burnt offering and offer it up in smoke. Okay, back to Genesis 22. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him, for I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." This phrase, "only son," appearing again and again, it's supposed to stick out to you and every time to be like, but wait a minute, there's another son. There's Ishmael. No, your only son. Not the byproduct of your works and your figuring things out and your efforts, but the son of promise, the son of supernatural birth, the son that came from a woman whose body was as good as dead, that son. He says, "Now I know what's in your heart. Don't lay your hand. I see you're willing to give your son in the same way that God would be willing to give his son." Also, the angel of the Lord. Who is the angel of the Lord? We've talked about it in the past. Not an angel of the Lord. It's the angel of Yahweh. He's the same one that appeared to him back in chapter 18. Three angels appear, but one is the Lord. Again and again, the angel of the Lord is when God takes on a physical form to talk to people, that's the angel of the Lord. He's not a created being. This is God the Son. This is Jesus stepping in, if you want to put it in those terms. This is Jesus seeing Abraham, says, "Abraham, don't slay your son." Now, if you look at it that way, it's really significant because he's saying, "Hold back, don't kill your son. I'll take my place on the wood. Don't kill your son. I'll take his place. But for now, I've got something else for you." Verse 13, "And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of the place, 'The Lord will provide,' as it said to this day, 'On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided.'" So you get a picture here. He's ready to slay his son. The angel of the Lord speaks to him, "Don't slay your son." And when he lifts up his eyes, he sees a ram on the same hill with his head in the thicket. Now the word for thicket is not big trees. It's the thick brush. It doesn't say it's a thorn bush, but I visualize a thorn bush. If so, just get the picture here. The head of the ram is stuck with his head in the thicket. Thicket, like a crown of thorns. Jesus wears the thorns on his head. Adam is told that the earth will produce thorns because of your sin, and Jesus wears the crown of thorns on his head. The ram has his head stuck in the thicket. I think it's a picture. "And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son." Now, once in a while, you'll read some evolutionists that'll say, well, ancient peoples believed in many gods, and eventually they evolved into monotheism. And originally, the priest told the stupid little people, "Hey, you need to bring your offerings to us because the gods are hungry." But the priests had their own interest in mind here because they got to eat the burnt offerings, and the stupid little people brought their lamb for the hungry god. And so it's about "I, the Lord thy God, am hungry," not "I am the Lord thy God." and the eternal God that created everything, but we've got hungry gods that need blood, they need food. That's a humanistic evolutionary perspective. From the beginning of the Bible, from the beginning of Genesis, the sacrifice of the ram is about substitutionary atonement. Adam, Eve, you deserve to die. I'm killing an animal in your place. In the stead of your sins, I am putting an animal as a sacrifice. It's not about God being hungry. In fact, in the Psalms, he said, if I were hungry, I would not tell you. I own the cattle on a thousand hills. It's not about God being hungry. It's about the death penalty. Your sin, the wages of sin is death. You deserve to die. You have sinned against me. You are guilty. But in your stead, instead of putting you in the dock, you in the electric chair, you in the noose, you on the altar, I am going to offer up a ram in your place, which serves as a picture of Christ, who is the Lamb without blemish. He says, the ram is in the stead of, instead of your son. Christ is in our stead. He became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. God places our sin on him because we're the ones that deserve to die. He dies in our place. This is a great significant event. And as in other significant events, Abraham gives the place a name. Verse 14, so Abraham called the name of that place Yahweh Yireh, the Lord will provide. The Lord will provide. Now, when I was a kid, I loved, we'd sing that song as a little kid. It was easy to remember, and I loved it. You know, Jehovah Jireh, my provider. We'd sing it, his grace is sufficient for me. And I just got the mind. I'd hear people talking about, oh, you know, I prayed, and the Lord, I didn't have money for my electric bill, and God provided me. Well, you know, God does that. God takes care of his people. He provides for us our daily bread. We pray for our daily bread. But this isn't about providing for your electric bill. This isn't about providing for your earthly needs. This is about providing for your sin. This is about providing atonement. This is about providing a victim, a sacrificial victim for your sins. And he says, on the mount of the Lord, the mount of Yahweh, it shall be provided. God is going to provide a substitute for your sins on a particular mountain near Jerusalem. That's the promise here. He named it Yahweh Yireh. In the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided. Because Christ would die for your sins, I believe, in that very place. If not, near that very place. If the Jews are right and it refers to Jerusalem, it's still in the proximity of Jerusalem and it's still beautiful and significant. But I tend to think that Christ would die in the very place where Isaac needs a substitute. So in the same place, Isaac would have a substitute twice. First time a ram and the second time the real lamb. In John 1:29, John the Baptist, he's been preaching repentance. He's been preaching repentance and confession of sin. He's been telling people, turn from your sins, prepare your heart to meet the Lord. In verse 29, the next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. What is he saying? All of the lambs, the lamb in Genesis chapter 3, the lamb of Genesis chapter 4 that Abel offers up, the lamb of Exodus chapter 12 on the Passover, the lamb or the ram that was offered up in Genesis chapter 22, the lamb of Leviticus chapter 1, the lamb of 2 Chronicles chapter 21 that was offered up on the mountain in order to stay the plague. All of the lambs of the Old Testament point to the Lamb of God, the Lamb without blemish, who takes away our sins. Not to a system. Not Jesus plus a religious system. Not Jesus plus your prayers, plus your church attendance, plus your tithes and offerings, plus leaving the church something in your will. Not that. It's Jesus is the substitute for our sins. Christ alone, grace alone, faith alone. Verse 15. And the angel of Yahweh called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, by myself I have sworn, by myself I'm swearing, declares Yahweh, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of his enemies. And in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed because you have obeyed my voice. Now, we've talked over and over again, Galatians chapter 2, that the offspring, the seed, singular, Paul makes the point that it's singular. It's not referring to the entire Jewish people. But in your offspring, and here it even uses the word his or him, refers to Christ. Because Christ would be the descendant of Abraham through Isaac. But he's the son of Abraham, but he's also the son of God. And in Christ, he says, I will bless you. And I will multiply your offsprings as the stars of heaven. And Christ will possess the gates of his enemies, which he does. And Christ shall all the nations of the earth be blessed. He obeyed, he believed. And the promise is through the seed, not a seed, not seed plural, but seed singular, Jesus Christ. In him all the nations shall be blessed. Verse 19, so Abraham returned to his young men, and they arose and went together to Beersheba, and Abraham lived at Beersheba. Abraham lived at the well of the oath, at the well of the seven lambs. He lived there, and we put our faith in Christ, and we live there. It's not one and done, forget about it, walk down an altar, sign a card, or something like that. No, it's who believes and continues to believe. So we come to the New Testament. The most famous verse in the Bible, the most memorized verse in the Bible, John 3:16, held up at football games. Maybe you'll read it a different way. Verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. That's the point of this morning's passage. God gave his only Son. That phrase, only Son, came up again and again. I should have counted it. I think it probably four or five times. Take your Son, your only Son, the Son that you love, your only Son, your only Son, your only Son. And every time raising an objection, but you have another Son, but you have another Son, but you have another Son. Even here you could say, but Satan is the Son of God by creation, along with all the other angels. And Adam was a Son of God, and I'm adopted as a Son of God. But he's the unique Son, the only Son, the monogenes, that whoever believes, Abraham believed that God would give him his son back, would raise him from, he believed in the resurrection. In type and shadow, he believed in the death, burial, and resurrection, and the promise of God that he would provide for him a substitutionary atonement. Now, when you read John 3:16, think Genesis 22. That Abraham was spared from giving his only son that he loves, but God gave his only son that he loves, that whoever believes in him, trusts in him, like Abraham trusted in him, should not perish in hell for eternity, but have eternal life, not for a little while, but have eternal life. This poor woman called me, I don't remember if it was 6 months or a year ago. I think she lives in Colorado. I have no idea where she got my number, but she looked up our church. I don't know if she saw something. She called me, and she said, I think I've committed the unforgivable sin. I can't be forgiven. And I reasoned with her for a good hour on the phone, I think. Long time, anyway. I know it was a long time. Dinner was on the table. But I'm talking with this lady. I'm reasoning with this woman. I'm sharing the gospel with her. I'm telling her to trust in Christ. She says, oh, I had, you know, all these feelings and all these things, and now I don't feel that anymore, and I know God, I know I'm damned, and I know I can't be saved. And I'm talking with this woman like crazy. She, the other night, on Friday night, she texts me. I'm getting ready to leave here. I had a meeting here. It's like 10:30 at night. And I texted her again back and forth for 30 minutes. She's got this thing in her head. And I just keep giving her scripture, giving her the gospel. I'm like, you've got to trust. Quit trusting your feelings. Trust in Christ. Look to Christ. If Christ has died for you, then you are saved. If you've never looked to Christ, look to him now. Trust in him now. You got to trust in him. Not in your feelings, not in your chills and your thrills. You've got to trust in Christ. I don't know if it got through to the woman. But God gave his only Son that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. It's eternal. Forever. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him, whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the Son of God. Now, in the Greek, when it says to believe on Jesus, it's an ongoing verb here. It's not a one and done. It continues to trust. Abraham lived in Beersheba. He lived in the vow of the oath. We are to live in the place of faith in Christ. Continue in faith in Christ. Don't move from there. He says, I didn't come into the world to condemn the world. The world was already condemned. You know, sometimes people get mad that not everybody's saved or not everybody want to be saved is saved. Do you realize God doesn't have to save anybody? If God had damned the whole human race, our father Abraham, Adam, waged war on God, we were born continuing this war. God is not obligated to show mercy. If he was, it wouldn't be mercy. God's not obligated to show mercy to you. The world was condemned. And Christ didn't come into the world to condemn the world. It's already condemned. He came into the world that whosoever would believe in him would have eternal life. That the one believing would have eternal life. Because he who has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son he's condemned already. Verse 19, and this is the judgment. Why is all of mankind damned and in trouble? This is the judgment, that light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his work should be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. Now, something's very interesting said here, that the reason why people hate the light is because their deeds are evil and they don't want their deeds exposed. And what we have to, when we come to Christ, we come and we bring our sins to the light. We quit trusting in ourselves. Cain was angry at the truth that if you do well, you'll be accepted. He was angered at that thought. We have to humble ourselves, bring our sins to the light, confess our sins. Anybody who's trusting in themselves is still condemned. Anybody who's trusting in a religious system is still condemned. Anybody who's trusting in anything except for Jesus Christ, anything except the Lamb of God, is lost in condemnation. Well, it says that he does what is true, comes to the light. But who comes to the light? Romans 1 says that we're all suppressing the truth in unrighteousness. We're all living in a lie. Who comes to him? I got one more scripture for you. This is it. John 6, 35 to 40. All that the Father gives me will come to me. And whoever comes to me, I will never cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Abraham believed and trusted God that he was able to raise up his son out of the ashes. And now the same thing is required of us. Come to him. He says, I will never cast you out. I will raise you up on the last day. Trust in him. By the way, one thing I neglected to mention earlier, we have this picture of Abraham bringing a little boy. Floyd Nolan Jones, who works out chronology, did some math and came to the conclusion that, by the way, the word youth here isn't little boy. It's simply young youth. That Isaac is around 28 years old. That's a very different picture than some little kid and taking him and tying him up to the altar. I don't know about you, but when I was 28, I was stronger and more fit than I am now at 47. If Isaac had not submitted to the father, if Isaac would have fought back, Abraham couldn't have tied him to the altar. Isaac had to voluntarily yield himself to his father and say, Abraham, not my will, but thine be done. What a picture. That Christ was willing. He's not a murder victim. He's a willing sacrifice. And if you trust in him and come to him, he says he will not cast you out. He will accept everyone who comes to him. I will never cast out. And also, I love this words. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he gives me. So the Father gives and we come. We come and he loses nothing. But he raises up on the last day. If you've come to Christ and truly put your faith in what Christ has done for you as your substitutionary atonement, God will be raising you up on the last day to eternal life. It's certain, because God has vowed it. He has swore it by an oath, and God is not a man that he should lie. The question is, are you trusting in Christ? Trust in Christ alone and have the assurance of your salvation. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, O Lord God, that you did not withhold your Son, the only Son that you love. We thank you, God, that we are accepted in the Beloved, apart from our works, but by the works of Christ. That not only did Christ die for us, but he lived for us. He lived a life of perfect obedience. He kept the law so that at a mature age, not a little child, but as a mature man, willingly, voluntarily offered up, he could die for our sins. Thank you, Lord. Father, I pray if there's any lack of clarity from this morning's sermon for anyone here, that God, you would make it clear to them that if they come to you, trusting in what Christ has done for them, and surrender to you, that they can have the assurance of their salvation and know that they have eternal life, because you are not a man that you should lie. You have swore it by an oath that all that trust in you, it shall be provided for. In the mount of the Lord, it shall be seen. And we praise you, Lord God, for what you have accomplished. In Jesus' name, amen.